84 to 86. Undoubtedly, the U-Men. They were the freshest, they were the most inventive, they were the most intense. After that, you see Green River and the Melvins and Malfunction and Soundgarden as well. You could see the sensibility, this aesthetic that was forming.
In Seattle, that there was a spirit of cooperation and camaraderie.
A lot of times, the members of our audience would be other bands that we knew in town. We would go to their shows as well, so it was like this really good kind of network.
There was absolutely a sense of camaraderie and community within the scene. It's a meeting ground, so we'd organize people and develop community. It was at a very human scale.
Our Super Unknown record debuted at number one.
Saw Soundgarden at the Central Tavern. That was really good.
Seeing this thing that you felt like kind of was your baby just be, you know, accepted globally, and it was exciting.
It seemed like there were so many darn good bands and so little places for them to play it.
There wasn't a lot of clubs around.
There was only Squid Row, the Central, and the Vogue.
The Central Tavern, the Ditto Tavern.
Squid Row shows were always like the most manic and fun.
I used to play Hall of Fame a lot. Great club.
Back in 88, the biggest scene was at the Vogue.
The Vogue.
The Vogue.
It'd be the Vogue on Tuesdays and the Central on Saturdays.
The first band I was in is called Nirvana. I've never really been in any other bands. Pretty amazing, huh?
Never expected anything to come from any of these bands, you know.
Because we knew that the music we were making was no way was it gonna ever be on TV.
Okay, the first there was the very early major label signings. Then there was the Sub Pop explosion, which happened around the same time. And then there was the, I guess, the Nirvana explosion, then the Pearl Jam explosion.
Nirvana and then Michael Jackson. I was like, whoa.
Well, as things became very popular very quickly, my life became very surreal, and the lives of people around me became very surreal.
It's like Nirvana didn't go to the mainstream. It's like the mainstream came to Nirvana. And up, like the spaceship Challenger, and then it exploded, right? It's like Dave and I landed, right? But Kurt didn't. See, that's a tragedy. But I think that Nirvana was a big failure, like as a band, like really failed. Because we had the world in the palm of our hands, and we just blew it. You know what I mean? Because we couldn't deal.
And I guess those guys have their own reasons to be sad, but for me, it was a lot of fun.
The first time I recorded the Screaming Trees, they were there. They were rocking the studio. They were going nuts, and they had the psychedelic thing totally down.
The songs themselves, I think, were completely formed when we first got in the studio. It was great. You know, I wouldn't change a thing. And chains. Made great records. Great band. They did more than most bands ever dream of doing.
I
felt
it was, the whole Seattle thing was oversaturated, you know, by 89 or something probably, you know, it seemed so ridiculous and it just kept getting more ridiculous, you know, like every week or something.
But the insane marketing hysteria, I just thought was hilarious.
Grunge rock fashion.
There was like a Vogue fashion spread.
Fashion.
Pretty funny.
Larry Bud Melman.
Thanks, phone dude.
It was the ultimate. The level of popularity that happened was just, it was phenomenal. It was such a powerful force, and I don't think anybody was ready for that. You know, as much as people might have fantasized about it, the reality came too fast, too soon.